Tonight on NewsWatch, Colorado declares a state of emergency as flash floods turn roads to rivers and force thousands to flee their homes.
Plus, 20 years ago today, Israel and the PLO signed a peace agreement in a White House ceremony. So where do things stand today? We'll show you.
And Superbook goes to Indonesia, the world's largest Muslim nation. We'll show you how kids are responding to the gospel message in their own language. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. Colorado is reeling from devastating flash floods. Good evening. I'm Mark Martin.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. Colorado officials have urged thousands of people to evacuate their homes and seek shelter on higher ground. At least three people have been killed, and some towns are completely cut off by the raging waters. Charlene Israel has more.
Torrential downpours continue as massive flooding wreaks havoc across parts of Colorado. At least 6 inches of rain fell in just 12 hours, flooding homes and the University of Boulder, Colorado. Highways and roads have been turned into rivers, causing streets to cave, trapping drivers inside their cars.
We were able to use ropes to stabilize the vehicles first, and then we had the rescue boats and were able to break in and then, you know, pull them out of the vehicle.
People living in the flood-ravaged city of Boulder have been ordered to evacuate after a creek began rising to dangerous levels. North of Boulder, failing dams trapped one family in the second floor of their home. Shelters have been opened for evacuated or displaced residents. Remote mountain communities have been completely cut off by washed out roads. Mudslides and rock slides have also been reported. The bad weather is also hampering rescue efforts as responders try to make their way to some of the most affected areas.
It was really like driving up a river, is how I'd put it.
Officials say the flash floods have turned deadly, claiming the lives of several people. One person was killed when their car was swept away by floodwaters.
We know that we've lost lives. We anticipate that as the day goes on, that we may find that we've lost others.
Thursday, President Obama approved federal disaster relief for the state after a request from Colorado's governor.
I wish it would just stop raining. Colorado's typically dry and we always pray for rain. I think we got our wish and then some.
Charlene Israel, CBN News.
U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry and Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov clashed today over what to do about Syria's chemical weapons. The two are in Geneva for talks. Russia has offered a proposal to quarantine and destroy Syria's chemical weapons. But the Syrian regime wants 1 month to start handing over information about its chemical stockpiles. Kerry rejected that offer, saying words alone will not solve the problem, and Russia needs to work with Syria to start handing over weapons immediately.
Jews in Israel and around the world are marking Yom Kippur, the holiest day on the Jewish calendar. This year, the holiday falls on the 20th anniversary of the signing of the Oslo Accords on the White House lawn. That ceremony was supposed to bring an era of peace between Israelis and Palestinians, but as John Waggy explains, the promises of land for peace have not materialized.
September 13, 1993 was hailed as an historic day when Israel and the Palestinians would begin to put their differences aside.
Enough of blood and tears. Enough!
The concept seems simple enough. Israel would give up West Bank territories it won in the 1967 Six-Day War, while the Palestinians would recognize Israel and get their own state, and the two peoples could live side by side in peace and security. But a Palestinian Authority government mired in corruption had different ideas, and through the 90s, terrorist groups increased their campaign against Israelis. Also, just 2 years after the White House ceremony, Rabin was murdered by an Israeli gunman. The peace process moved forward anyway, and President Clinton almost brokered a deal at Camp David in which the Israelis would give up most of the West Bank and part of Jerusalem. But Palestinian leader Yasser Arafat rejected the U.S. brokered agreement, and the result was a second intifada and a wave of terror attacks, leading to more than 2,000 dead on both sides. Former Palestinian negotiator Ahmed Correa says Israel is at fault.
I blame the Israeli leaders for two reasons. One, they have the power. Second, they are the occupier. And they want the Palestinian, everything in their pocket, and they want to take more from the empty pocket of the Palestinians.
Under pressure from the West, the peace process continued, but the Bush administration departed from past U.S. policy and refused to deal with Arafat, seeing him as part of the problem rather than the solution. With Mahmoud Abbas in power after Arafat's death, the Israelis under Ariel Sharon pulled out of the Gaza Strip in 2005, uprooting more than 8,000 Jewish residents from their homes. They hoped it would lead to peace. Instead, it led to elections favoring the radical Hamas, an eventual Hamas dictatorship in Gaza, and thousands of rocket attacks on a growing number of Israeli cities. By this time, many Israelis had begun to realize that their concessions weren't leading to peace.
Enough with giving land, enough with concessions, enough with President Obama telling us, go back to the 67 lines. We will not do it. We will not get out from our homeland. We will build in Judea and Samaria.
This spring, U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry tried to jumpstart talks between the Palestinian Authority and the Netanyahu government. But in September, as Israelis marked their holiest day of the year with signs of war all around them, the promise of Oslo seems like a distant memory. John Waghi, CBN News.
Thanks, John. Muslims in southern Egypt killed two Christian men for failing to pay them protection money. As CBN News reported earlier, Muslims in the area are demanding Christians pay them jizya. That's a kind of Islamic tax that non-Muslims can be forced to pay. But the tax is so high, many Egyptian Christians simply can't afford it. The Voice of the Martyrs reports that a Muslim man demanded a Christian in a village in Asiut pay him nearly $1,500. The Christian sought help from local police, but to no avail. When he couldn't come up with the money, several Muslims went to his home and shot him and his cousin to death. International correspondent Gary Lane has been following this story. And for more, you can go to his blog on our website, cbnnews.com.
Taliban fighters attacked a U.S. consulate in western Afghanistan today, killing two Afghan security agents. Suicide attackers unleashed two car bombs at the consulate in Herat near the Iranian border. Reports indicate Afghan and U.S. special forces helped secure the compound, killing five attackers in a gun battle. No attackers managed to breach the compound, and all U.S. personnel at the site are safe. But the brazen attack underscores the dangerous security situation as U.S. troops prepare for a full withdrawal next year.
Al-Qaeda leader Ayman al-Zawahiri is calling on Muslims to carry out attacks inside the United States. He said Islamic holy warriors can defeat America on its own soil, and he urged them to carry out small and large strikes, finding any opportunity to, quote, bleed America financially. The message was posted on a jihadist website used by Al-Qaeda.
New satellite images show the Arctic ice cap is making a comeback. The British paper The Daily Mail reports the polar ice cap expanded by 60% in just 1 year. You can see the before and after shots in these satellite photos. The news media have blamed global warming for the previously shrinking ice cap. An environmentalist warned that all the melted ice would flood the world. Back in 2007, the BBC even predicted that all the ice would have melted by 2013. Instead, as you just saw there, the opposite happened this year. Meanwhile, one environmentalist website is proposing naming hurricanes after politicians who don't believe in climate change. Forecasters have predicted a worse than normal Atlantic hurricane season. Ironically, this season is off to a very slow and mild start.
Weird. Well, coming up, how school children in the world's largest Muslim nation are learning about the Bible.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits.
Jim is 38, mortgage, married, three great kids. He wants to protect his family with a $500,000 term life insurance policy. What do you think it'll cost him? $100 a month? $60? $40? Actually, none of the above. Jim can get a $500,000 policy from a highly rated insurer for under $19 a month. His secret? SelectQuote. SelectQuote is impartial. They'll comparison shop the pick of insurance companies like these to give you a choice of your best prices. SelectQuote has great savings on term life for women, too. Jim's wife, Deidre, can get a $500,000 policy for under $16 a month. SelectQuote has helped make term life insurance affordable for hundreds of thousands of people since 1985. How about you? Just call this number or go to SelectQuote.com. SelectQuote. We shop, you save.
Obamacare is proving unpopular even with some of the president's political allies in the labor movement. The AFL-CIO has approved a resolution criticizing parts of the new law that comes despite efforts by the White House to discourage the group from making its concerns so prominent. The strongly worded resolution says the health care law will drive up the costs of union-sponsored health plans to the point that workers and employers are forced to abandon them. Labor unions still support the goals of Obamacare to cut health care costs and provide coverage to all Americans, but they say the law as it stands now will hurt union health plans.
On the other side of the aisle, Sarah Palin is stirring things up as the Obamacare October 1st deadline approaches. Her PAC has released an ad called Just Saying. It's loaded with the latest evidence of Obamacare death panels. Take a look.
The shocking truth about Obama's health care plan.
Did that sound like a death panel to you?
The little girl is a prime example of a bureaucrat being able to make that decision is a scary thing.
This bill was always going to lead to rationing.
But the important thing to remember is that's just one aspect of Obamacare.
I know that sounds scary to many folks. It sounds scary to me, too.
Why wasn't there just more honesty through this whole process?
Wow. Well, the former Alaska governor has raised these concerns before. The difference now is some far-left Democrats appear to agree with her.
Well, a humanist group has filed a lawsuit to stop a South Carolina public school from holding its fifth-grade graduation ceremonies at a Christian university. The American Humanist Association wants to stop the school from holding future ceremonies at a university affiliated with the South Carolina Baptist Convention. It also seeks to stop school-sponsored prayer at future events. The school district spokesman says the group's position, quote, would require the district to demonstrate hostility, not neutrality, toward religion, which is a violation of the First Amendment.
CBN Superbook will soon be seen on television screens in the world's largest Muslim country. Some Indonesian school kids recently received a preview of the Emmy-nominated series. Lucille Talusan brings us their reaction.
The CBN Superbook team are touring several schools in Indonesia.
Superbook!
CBN Indonesia director Mark McClendon says the Superbook broadcast will be historic.
Never before in the history of missions in Indonesia has there been an opportunity like this, where you can present Christ, and you can present Christ in context of the entire Bible, the whole mission of the heart of God.
Tigris, Euphrates.
Superbook has been translated into Bahasa, the Indonesian language.
I mean, it's so cool. And Gizmo lights up in the Indonesian language, and kids just go wild.
It premieres September 14th on MNNC TV, Indonesia's third largest network. MNNC runs 80% of the country's top children's programs.
This is the first time that Superbook is being promoted in the schools here in Indonesia. And what's interesting is the very enthusiastic response of the children here. And among the students are Muslims listening and given the opportunity to learn about God's word in animation.
The Muslim parents say they like their children to learn the values they see in Christian children. They allow their children to study Christian religion because they believe it is just like any other subject.
Kami tidak takut padamu.
Kenapa harus takut?
The students gave their full attention as they watched the first Superbook episode. Not only were they delighted with the state-of-the-art animation, but they were also moved by the story.
I pray that I will not fight anymore with my brother, and I will stop speaking bad words.
I'm excited because I know that kids everywhere are going to be singing, Jesus kamati di salim. They're going to be singing the salvation poem. They're going to, because Superbook is the seed.
Jesus kauma tiri salib. Lucille Talusan, CBN News, Jakarta.
Thanks, Lucille. Well, up next, modern-day Israelis talk about life in what's known as the West Bank and the pressure to give that land to the Palestinians.
Hello? Is this thing on? Hey, kids. Do you love games? And do you love discovering things? Yeah! Well, do you? Yeah!
Then you're gonna love this. It's the new free Superbook Kids Bible app. You can play games, watch videos, find answers to your questions, and a whole lot more. The new Superbook Kids Bible app. Free downloads available on iTunes and Google Play now.
In 2008, my husband, Gary, departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Announcing an important breakthrough in healthcare that can benefit everyone. If you or anyone you love needs affordable health insurance, regardless of a pre-existing medical condition, call Quick Insurance 123 today and get the immediate relief you deserve. Quick Insurance 123 was created to provide affordable health insurance to all uninsured Americans, with or without pre-existing conditions. This is not a discount card. This is a real insurance program that lets you choose from many affordable health plans, with access to doctors, hospitals, emergency services, and more. So call the number on your screen now and get the health coverage you need, just for calling. As a special bonus, we'll send you a free prescription savings card that could save you up to 85% on your prescriptions. That's right, you could save up to 85% on your prescriptions, just for calling. Call Quick Insurance 123 to find out how you can get affordable health insurance and receive your free prescription savings card, just for calling. Don't wait. Getting a free quote is as easy as 123. Call today.
Well, as we mentioned earlier, it's been 20 years since Israel and the Palestinians signed the Oslo Peace Accords. Instead of peace, though, we've seen endless negotiations and lots of violence.
Now, once again, we have peace talks. The stakes are high for Israelis since the Palestinians want to take part of the promised land to create their own state. Recently, Scott Ross talked with some Israelis about their ongoing struggle.
Known to much of the world as the West Bank, Judea and Samaria of the Bible is today home to some 360,000 Jewish Israelis and at least 1.4 million Palestinian Arabs.
Shiloh.
Shiloh.
Okay. The first capital of ancient Israel.
That's right.
The place where the tabernacle stood for 369 years.
Whoa.
David Rubin is the former mayor of Shiloh, the place pronounced Shiloh in hundreds of biblically named places in America. We talked together overlooking the route in which the biblical patriarchs Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob would have traveled.
This is where Joshua stood before the Israelites and he said, "How long will you wait before coming to take possession of the land that the Lord God of your fathers has given you?" This is the place where the woman Hannah came to pray for a son. The son who was born from her prayers was Samuel the prophet, who grew up into prophecy in Shiloh along with the people of Israel.
And that is the issue that remains today. This is the land that God gave you.
As a special responsibility to cherish it and to take care of it.
Reuben's commitment to the land came at a personal price when he and his son were ambushed by terrorists while traveling on the road home.
The car was hit by a massive hail of bullets, and I was shot in my leg, my son was shot in the head.
Is your son still alive today?
Thank God my son is alive today. He had a miraculous recovery. The bullet missed his brain stem by 1 millimeter.
Why do people choose to live in the middle of the threat of violence, their children, so forth, being exposed to this? Why do people want to be here?
We've come home. We're fulfilling prophecy in these times.
Some 230 Israeli families live in Shiloh today, 35 years after it was reestablished in 1978. And yet Palestinian Authority Chairman Mahmoud Abbas said recently that a future Palestinian state in this area must be completely free of Jews.
There never was a Palestinian state. It's all an illusion. It's all a political game by the Islamic world to try and make sure that Israel doesn't have the right to exist anymore. And
how do you feel about the land for peace negotiations? You give up the land, there's going to be peace.
It's time for a new plan, which is called Peace for Peace.
Which is?
Which is we extend our hand in peace, they extend their hand in peace, we shake it and we have peace, we sign a peace treaty, and all is well.
Shiloh is in biblical Samaria, north of Jerusalem. Judea and Samaria, including the Jordan Valley, is 79 miles long and between 19 and 34 miles wide. To the south of Jerusalem and Bethlehem is a large block of Jewish communities in Judea called the Gush Etzion, in another part of what the world calls the West Bank.
We're at the highest point in Gush Etzion. We're on the backbone of the hills that control the lowlands in both directions. And that is the Mediterranean Sea and the coastal plain, Tel Aviv, Ashdod, Ashkelon, down to Gaza. And we can see the rockets come out of there. And when you look this way, and we look east, we're looking towards Jordan. First, we have the hills here, which belong to Gush Etzion. They go from Hebron all the way up to Jerusalem. And there's Jordan on the other side. That's it, that's all we got. This is the width, and we're on top.
Ruthie Lieberman is a wife and mother. Originally from Ohio, she is raising her family in a community called Alon Shavuot, which means return to the oak tree in Gush Etzion. Jews established several farming communities here before the State of Israel in 1948. But during Israel's War of Independence, they were destroyed and the residents killed or driven away. After the 1967 Six-Day War, the Jews returned to rebuild here.
Who are your neighbors?
I think having Lebanon in the north, Syria to the northeast, then we come around and have Egypt to the south. We're not in a great area.
There are 24 Muslim states surrounding Israel from Morocco to Iran, more than 8 million square miles of land, more than 500 times the size of Israel, where some half a billion people live. Judea and Samaria stand between Israel's major population centers and the Arab world. Without it, in some places, Israel is just 9 miles wide.
The Arabs, many factions, Palestinians, hate the Jews. Do you hate the Arabs?
I don't think the Arabs who live nearby in the village over there, I don't think they hate me. Mm-hmm. I think they're taught to hate me. We have our Arab friend, whom I know by name, I know his profession, I know the names of his kids, he's behind the cheese counter with this huge cleaver. And he's there, you know, what can I get you? And he's our friend. And I'm not afraid, I'm actually encouraged.
20 years ago, then Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin and PLO leader Yasser Arafat signed the Oslo Accords and shook hands on the White House lawn. And still, there is no peace.
Do you see that this could possibly become a future Palestinian state?
If it were to become a Palestinian state, I would imagine that it would be because there's some huge breakthrough and the whole world believes that now we have peace in this part of the world. And if that's true, then I can live here. Mm-hmm. I'm Jewish. I bought the land and I should be able to keep my home. In every talks that we hear, we're out of the picture. We'll have to pack up and go.
The scriptures teach us to pray for Jerusalem, pray for Israel. Do you think it makes any difference?
I hope that all of you continue to pray for Jerusalem every day. It strengthens us. It strengthens our psyche. It strengthens our hopes. We know that we're not alone.
Attention, sleep apnea patients. Are you tired of the expense and hassle of getting your CPAP and BiPAP supplies? Are you fed up with dealing with ill-fitting, leaking, or worn-out masks and straps? Are you worried about the effects that unsanitary tubes, cushions, and filters have on your health? If you said yes to any of these questions, Allied Medical Supply Network has the solution to your problems. You could qualify to have your supplies regularly delivered right to your door at little or no cost to you. That's right, no more inconvenience, no worn-out masks and straps, no more unsanitary equipment, just restful sleep. Call Allied Medical Supply Network today to determine if you may qualify to receive your fresh, brand-name supplies at little or no cost. Don't delay. Call us now to see if you are eligible to save money on regular delivery of your CPAP and BiPAP supplies. Call 1-800-815-9947. That's 1-800-815-9947. Or go to CPAPSupplyHelpline.com.
Announcing an important breakthrough in healthcare that can benefit everyone. If you or anyone you love needs affordable health insurance, regardless of a pre-existing medical condition, call Quick Insurance 123 today and get the immediate relief you deserve. Quick Insurance 123 was created to provide affordable health insurance to all uninsured Americans, with or without pre-existing conditions. This is not a discount card. This is a real insurance program that lets you choose from many affordable health plans, with access to doctors, hospitals, emergency services, and more. So call the number on your screen now and get the health coverage you need, just for calling. As a special bonus, we'll send you a free prescription savings card that could save you up to 85% on your prescriptions. That's right, you could save up to 85% on your prescriptions, just for calling. Call Quick Insurance 123 to find out how you can get affordable health insurance and receive your free prescription savings card, just for calling. Don't wait. Getting a free quote is as easy as 123. Call today.
Technology helps us connect across long distances.
Sure does. And for a seventh grader with a rare form of cancer, technology is also helping him stay in school. Right now, Kyle Weintraub lives in Philadelphia for a year of treatment, but he's still attending his school in Florida by using a Vigo robot.
I can make the robot spin so I can see the whole classroom. So it's basically just like I'm there.
He's no longer isolated. He is part of the class. He's a normal kid.
He probably wants to learn, even though he can't be here. He wants to, like, see his friends.
Kyle uses his computer to maneuver the robot through the school. He not only attends class, but hangs out with his friends, too. Friends that helped him raise $6,000 to pay for this robot. Though he's several states away, he's not missing out on a thing, even homework, Mark.
That is amazing.
That's pretty cool, isn't
it? Yeah, so futuristic,
technology.
But right here now. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, God bless him. We pray he gets well quick. And that's all for this edition of NewsWatch.
Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend.